Tyler woman. I enjoy touring or two. I hang out at a Baptist church, but my in-laws are Catholic, so, you know, I had to have a legal way in. And
Karen,
I'm a public health doctor.
Karen,
working.
The microphone fell down.
Oh, did it? And I'm a public health doctor working in the Canterbury DHB, and I wonder if you're interested in an article. And so it was Michael Hill was the editor then, and he was very warm and supportive and said, sure, send something in. And, you know, for the last 13 years or 14 years, I've been they've been very welcoming and very supportive. And Frances Skelton was very encouraging, and then there was Kevin, and then there was Elizabeth, and then there was Anne, and then there was Anne. And so it's been really lovely to be part of the team. And the editors almost do no editing of my work. They never tell me what to write about. And I almost never submit the article by the due date, but it's usually only a couple of days late. And when I sit down to write something, I usually have only the most wispy ideas, very spiderweb-like. And then I just sit down and I think Anne Lamott talks about a shitty first draft, and that is pretty much what the first effort is. But it just, you know, work on it for a couple of, on and off for a couple of days and then send it off again. And particularly in the early days, my husband Jeff is a really good writer, and he's been very helpful in wordsmithing, so he helped. But now I've got my daughter Shanti here tonight, and she's just started at Victoria, and she's already a regular contributor to Salient, and she's a good wordsmith, so she's even helping with the odd editing. So I've got a good team behind me. So that was how I started on Tui Motu, and it was, you know, a mother's journal for quite a long time, and then has become looking out and in. And I guess the idea right through is just how is a sort of practical practice of Christianity that has been a good practice for me spiritually. And I've got my spiritual director Adrian Thompson over here today as well, so I'm really nice to have some whānau support. So what I wanted to talk about today was, as a kind of meta theme, it's from this idea of our names for you, God, have been too few. And it's from a liturgy that I came across at Easter time. It's by an Episcopalian white man, American, but nevertheless a really great writer, is called Douglas McSweeney. And it was a liturgy that was just going around the idea of our names for you, God, have been too few. And it's sort of like our concept of God has been often I think for all of us, it's too narrow, it's too short-sighted, and there's always, God is just much bigger. And so this is what he wrote at the start of that liturgy. You are the Lord of vast empty spaces. You are the Lord of atoms, the black hole king, the Lord of speeding light, High King of galaxies, weaver of the unseen fabrics of the world, ruler of electrons. You are the God of justice, the God of wisdom, the God of mercy, the God of redemption, the Lord of love. But our names for you are still too few. Our minds are too small to conceive of them all, let alone contain them. You were before all things, you created all things, and in you all things are held together. There is no corner of creation you will fail to redeem. And so when I found this, I felt like this actually feels like, you know, my life lesson, which I'm still learning. And so I felt like it was a good kind of banner for what I was wanting to share tonight. And I think it works quite well for Pentecost as well. That was McKelvey's website. And this is a Pentecost picture, but I think because Pentecost is that time when the Holy Spirit is moving in the mysterious, marvelous, energetic ways that none of us can even imagine or understand. And I feel like every year I'm understanding a little bit more of how big and unknowable God is. And I actually was thinking it's very much like perhaps our dog Eddie, who lives in India, and he was a bizarre dog who was abandoned. Very, very sweet dog, I have to say. But he, you know, he thinks he knows me. I think I know him, but I don't. I think there's a lot about me that Eddie doesn't get. And you know, I just wave him off, and I go off on a bus, and I go to New Zealand, and he's like, oh, well, she's back soon. And you know, I wonder if it's like that with us, with God, that we just have this quite narrow idea. So this evening I wanted to talk about three invitations that I have been thinking about in the past few years. Three things I'm slowly learning. One of these is the invitation to generosity, both to receive and to give generously. The second is an invitation to listen to small and excluded voices, to people on the margins. And the third invitation is to participate in the bringing the reign of God. So I just wanted to talk about each of those and what they've meant for me. So first of all, the invitation to generosity. And within that, there are three metaphors or three ideas that have been really important to me. I think anyone who's read my column regularly, I've tended to go on about rivers and monsoon quite a bit. And rivers it was a small river by a community health clinic that we moved to as a family in 2005 in North India. And that river was called the Jibinala, and this is a picture of one of the water mills there. And it was a river that just had so many ways of giving to the people in the community. So one of the ones that I particularly loved doing science lessons with the kids was they made little channels and turned a water wheel, which then turned this monstrous flat stone in which ground flour for everyone in the village. There were also these intricate little irrigation ditches that went out and watered all the fields. And then there was the plastic pipes that went off to people's homes, and the water could be used for washing dishes or for showering or for anything else. And then when our friend Rana's dad died, the whole village came down to the edge of the river, each with a piece of firewood, and Rana's dad's body was put on the pyre, and after he was burned, the ashes were thrown into the river, and off they went swirling down the river, and I guess eventually got to the Arabian Sea. And I guess that it feels like rivers are just so diverse in the ways that they give to us, and they give, for one person it's like that, and for another it's in a different way, and I guess I feel like that God is like that. That for one person God gives in one way, and another person God is present in another way, and yet all of those are valid ways to be a river, and all of those are valid ways to receive the water of the river. So that's one metaphor that helps me understand God's generosity, and to also trust that God's ways of being present for different people are all valid. The monsoon is another metaphor that I was just flipping through a few old columns, like, really, I think I've overdone monsoon a bit. but I do love it. And when you live in North India, it is so pervasive and inescapable, and so excessive, and so tenacious, and so wet. And it is quite tedious where we live at 2,000 metres above sea level, and so it's actually a lovely, cool climate. We get snow in winter, but we basically live in a cloud for 3 months, and when we go back to New Zealand in July, I'll just be bracing myself for the green mold on my shoes, and all the kids get asthma, and it's very moldy. But we also just have this beautiful ferns and greenery and algae and, you know, just greenness everywhere. And I think that pervasiveness, there's no corner where monsoon is not present. And so I think that also is for me another great metaphor for God's love. A sort of pervasiveness that, you know, there's no place you can be out of the reach of God's unstoppable love. But the way God is present is even more evident is in people. And I wanted to share the story of Shabnam. I've mentioned that I, as a public health doctor, I'm leading a program with the Emmanuel Hospital Association in working with people with mental illness. And Shabnam is a woman who's similar age to me, and she said it was time for me to share her story. This is Shabnam here. She's grown up in a Muslim household, and her parents, she had quite severe epilepsy, and we work with neurological and psychiatric disorders. And so She was told it's best if you don't go to school because there's any chance you could have a seizure and you might get killed, hit by a car, so just best not to go to school. And so she missed out on so many things that all of us love about being able to read. Though she still can read the Quran, just the prayers for her five times a day prayer. And then she didn't get married because her family thought, well, you know, it's just, it would be bad if she passed that on, and we're not quite sure. And then she's also, her family aren't quite sure if it was contagious through food, so they said it might be better if you just stayed upstairs and eat separately. And so she's had this incredibly lonely, disabled life with a disorder that, you know, lots of people in New Zealand, you wouldn't even know they're not disabled in any way. But Shamil is, I'm not really telling her story so that we feel sad about her, because she's just a very gentle, very welcoming person. And we've set up some groups, psychosocial support groups for people with mental illness. And because she's Muslim and most of her neighbors are Hindu, they feel really safe to come and sit at her place and tell her. We've had like three or four women from her neighbors who are in domestic violence situations, and she's basically become a really great counselor. And it's this really great reciprocity where she provides a listening ear and a quiet, safe place where they'll come, and they know she's not going to go and tell all the neighbors. She's very respectful. But for her, it's suddenly, from having had years of isolation, she's suddenly got all these neighbors swinging by and talking to her. And so I guess that I feel like the love of God is like that, where you give and but then you receive, you know, abundantly more than you ever expected. And so that's the first invitation I wanted to share about, that the love of God is as multiform as the waters of a river. It's as persistent and pervasive as the monsoon, and as welcoming as the listening ears of a woman who's been lonely for many years. The second big theme I've been learning is the invitation to pay attention, to really listen to voices on the edge. And I think as a parent, the first place I'd start with that is really wanting to listen to children. And this is my husband, Jack, and me, and our four kids. Sharon and Shanti are twins, and so they've just both started university in New Zealand, which is partly why we're back here at the moment. Rohan's a 16-year-old going to Kashmir High at the moment. And he said, his observation on New Zealand is, in India I'm a white boy, but in New Zealand I'm a brown boy. And Janori is the youngest, she's nine. And her observation last week in Christchurch was, in New Zealand the rain is small and cold, and in India it's big and warm. So anyway, it's been interesting for them coming back and doing things. So I think all of us find it easiest to be with people who are like us. And we naturally seek out people who are like us, and I don't think there's anything wrong in that, but I think we're called to more than that. And I think there are just so many compelling examples in the Gospels. And, you know, if we had more time, we could just sit and brainstorm. But, you know, there's just so many examples of where Jesus deliberately and intentionally moves out of his comfort zone of, you know, educated male religious leaders, and he talks to women, he talks to people who are earning a living as a sex worker, he talks to people who are, you know, migrants in the town, he talks to people who are mad, who people who think they're possessed, you know, it's actually just so compelling. And so for me, this feels like just one of the most important messages of the Gospels that we often manage to miss. So I just thought I would share, as a mother, one of the ways that has been really important for me, and I'm quite a busy person who's always got a lot going on in my head, so I need to be a little intentional about actually stopping and paying attention to my kids. And this is a couple of quotes from the kids. I really like the idea that your toes are fizzy in a tight pair of shoes. And this one here, Shanti's sister Shah, saying, wouldn't it even be so funny if God didn't put bones into someone? And Shanti's like, you know, Shah, God doesn't make mistakes. Well, she doesn't make naughty mistakes, but sometimes might make an accident mistake. And, you know, I just think the theology and the, you know, what we can understand about God is just, there's so much there. And I think there's, you know, children was another group that Jesus.